Every single person on the planet is doing the same thing right now. They're seeking fulfillment. Every single action is motivated in the quest to find fulfillment. Where are you allocating your time to have the optimal human experience?
There's this Wolf of Wall Street, finance, career, and then there's this transformation to what you're doing today. An expert and someone that works with many people around leveraging meditation as a tool. All right, Tom, thanks for joining me, mate.
Great to be here.
I'm pretty excited about today's conversation.
Me too.
You've got a really interesting story. There's a bit in it, right?
Yeah, it's pretty colourful. Yeah. There's a few layers to it.
I promise I'll do my best to pull all the layers out and put them on the table and let everyone examine it, almost like a science experiment, if that's okay.
Sure, let's peel a veil back and have a look.
Sounds good. So for a lot of the listeners to this podcast, you know, we talk about the pursuit of performance. So I think everything we discuss here today will be around that idea of whether we're in business or you know, leadership or just life in general, what that means and why this might be important. But I think in your story alone, let alone the tool of meditation, which we'll probably dig into a little bit, there'll be plenty to play with, right? So do you mind if you just give us a bit of the backdrop? This, I use the word Wolf of Wall Street. You know, you played around the time where Jordan Belfort was out in his game as well, but maybe can you give us a bit of a history on who Tom is and how you landed here today?
Thanks for that. I started my career as a broker on a trading room floor in 1987, which was the same year that Jordan Belfort started his career as the Wolf of Wall Street. And for anyone that didn't know, that's actually a true story. He started at the age of 22. I was 19. He walked onto a massive trading room floor and was bitten by that. So got the bug of what that was like. And for me, the same thing happened. I was actually meant to go and do a degree in journalism at Macquarie University. And I was going to ironically write articles in magazines and newspapers about capitalistic greed, trying to save the world from the horrendous of greed and commercialism and capitalism. I've just been backpacking around the world, listening to Susie and the Banshees and the Smiths on my tape deck with books like Jean-Paul Sartre and Albert Camus, reading about French existentialism. And so I was a sort of very romanticized, youth thinking about it, my ambitions to change the world. And next thing I'm on a trading room floor, because what happened was I blew all my money traveling. I had to fill in just a few months to make some money before uni started. So I just applied the Saturday Morning Herald jobs in the paper and just wrote off to a heap of different jobs and managed to land this one on a trading room floor. Now I had no idea what it was or what it was all about, but it was really good money. And before long, within the 3 months of me eventually going to leave and go and do my degree, had given me a bonus, a pay rise, corporate Amex card, sports car. So I was like all in. And it was one of those things that every year, you know, I kept saying to myself, I'm going to leave at the end of this year and then I'm going to go and do my degree. I just need to get a bit more money. What happens is every year when you're a young kid, and I was actually surprisingly really good at the job, very fast, very efficient, picked it up really quickly. And because of that, I started getting bonuses and bonuses and bonuses. And it's like these golden handcuffs, they call them. Mm-hmm. And before long, it's almost impossible to leave because every year is another promise of a bigger pay rise and bigger bonuses. And you just keep seeing the money. And so I was hook, line, and sinker all in on that. And it was really interesting. Not only was the job just really intense and really frenetic, as you'd expect looking at Wolf of Wall Street, if anyone's seen it, but there was a lifestyle culture that not everyone was part of. Admittedly, it wasn't the whole industry, but I certainly became deep in that culture. And that was a lot of drinking, a lot of partying, a lot of drugs. Late 80s, early 90s. So things were kind of wild at that time. There was some pretty reckless, hedonistic behavior happening that certainly wouldn't, you know, be happening today, but it was pretty much a big part of that culture then. And so that led to really a lot of stress anomalies in the way I was experiencing life. It started showing up in a lot of anxiety, panic attacks, depression. And of course, because you got this incredible stress and stress responses showing up in your body without really understanding it, not knowing that you've got stress responses in the body, you're just feeling crap. And so to feel better when you feel crap, you keep doing more of the things that the addiction are giving you, which is these bigger highs, mm-hmm. which of course come with bigger lows. So you go deeper into the drugs, deeper into the drinking, deeper into the partying, deeper into your addictions. And that continued in a spiral until my late 20s when I had a full-blown nervous breakdown.
Yeah, wow, mate. It's, you know, I hope you don't mind, but I think there'll be some discussion about your, you know, where you are now and also discussion about the work you do. But I think it'd be great to just unpick a little bit of that. You know, and I can personally resonate. I felt, and I've been in an early stage of my career where I felt that golden handcuff experience just always on that next dopamine hit of the next deal and the next job, and you feel rewarded for it and the system rewards you for it. And you know, I was in a different game to you, but I certainly know that there can be a sense of many layers to that, right? That help that create that, as you describe, that anxiety and so on. What were the layers? What did it, if you can describe to people what it looked like on a day-to-day level for you when you were functioning at a, what it sounds like a pretty high level, you were performing with respect to that environment, but there was something broken in there. Can you take us through that?
Yeah, it's phenomenal how resilient the body is, you know, what I was putting it through. You know, we'd be out because a big part of the job was on the day trading was to execute deals really fast and really efficient for investment bankers all around the world that were yelling orders at you. So these squawk boxes with traders in multitude of different banks yelling orders at you, 5 mil, 10 mil, 20 mil, 50 mil, even 100 mil deals where you're buying and selling, executing these transactions in the market for them. So you have to be very fast and very efficient, but the big part of the job was to actually win those deals. So to win those deals required a lot of marketing. And so that meant taking clients out, you know, wine bars, nightclubs, strip clubs to the wee hours of the morning. So you'd be out a lot of weeknights till, you know, midnight, 2, 3, 4, 5 in the morning sometimes. It was not uncommon to, you know, find a broker sleeping underneath the desk so that they could save time. Instead of driving home and coming back to work, they just go straight to work, sleep under the desk and get back in the chair and do it all again, maybe wear a change of shirt. And so for me, you know, that was not uncommon to have really late nights with very little sleep, doing obviously a lot of things to keep you up all that night, drinking and drugs. But then the big problem was weekends for me. A lot of guys would just recuperate on the weekend, play a round of golf and, you know, sit on the sofa for most of the weekend and chill out. But I got really deep into the late 80s, early 90s rave culture, which was just exploding on the scene. So my weekends were deep in, you know, ecstasy world of raves, in warehouse parties in Alexandra and Redfern. Mm-hmm. And so my body really never had a chance to recuperate. And what it started to look like on a daily basis was, you know, really high functioning. So, you know, you'd be back on the floor, and when you're in that zone, you're just really in the zone and you'd be getting the deals done. It was outside of those times that it really showed up. You know, I'd get a lot of anxiety and panic attacks in the morning. Interestingly, it'd be on weekends and times when you're sort of having downtime that you'd get these really deep waves of deep fear and loathing, which was just these waves of panic attacks.
Yeah. What were you afraid of? What was the anxiety revolved around?
Yeah, it's not really a fear that you're like, oh, I hope this doesn't happen. You know, it's more that your body is in collapse mode, because what's happening is you've basically pushed your body for really long periods of time into sympathetic nervous system state. So the sympathetic nervous system state is a stress response, which is, if Braveheart, you know, the opening scene of that where Mel Gibson's going into battle.
Yeah.
We need a lot of things to actually change in your body in those precarious situations. It's a natural stress response for protection in those situations. So your body's shutting down the biochemicals of serotonin, melatonin, oxytocin, the chemicals of sleep, happiness, and love. But it's producing high levels of cortisol and adrenaline because your body's interpreting that you're in a battle scene.
Yeah.
So it's not like, oh gosh, I hope this trade doesn't go wrong. It's more that you're just in high adrenaline. And what happens is, because there's so much adrenaline in your blood, so much cortisol day in, day out, this fear type scenario, it just stays for long periods of time in your blood. And so when you're not distracted with having to get the job done, that adrenaline overrides in your body and then you just get swept along by that current.
Yeah, this is really interesting. There's, in my world, and I'm sure in your world, there's a lot of people that experience that consistent stress load or that sympathetic piece. And I'm no expert in your space, but I certainly observe it. And I'm curious, you know, a lot of people, there'll be a rationale around what they're noticing, but you put your body through a lot of pressure and a lot of stress, and it's turned into this almost like a normalization of, you know, an acceptance of that stress. How does that work? I mean, I'd love to understand that before we talk about transforming it. Simply because I know a lot of people, regardless of whether they're a mother, a father, you know, a small business owner, a leader of business, there's different people that may experience this, and it doesn't necessarily need to relate to hard drugs and rave parties.
Yeah, look, most of society's in that state now without even realizing it. So I was in a really extreme state of that, and that shows up with those anomalies. So those anomalies, think of it like a red light on a dashboard. Mm. The red light shows up as a signal to let you know that there's a problem underneath the hood. Mm. And the red light's not the problem. What's actually causing the red light to come on is the problem. So the symptom is the red light. It's not the problem. The problem is a deeper sense of hyperstimulation. It's based upon, we refer to the third law of thermodynamics. So we see that when there's hyperstimulation in a system, there's more disorder or chaos. When we see de-excitation of a system, there's more order and less chaos. So for instance, an example would be boiling water or a stadium. So a football stadium with 100,000 people, mm-hmm. if they calmly exit that stadium, they can leave that stadium in 5, 10, 15 minutes. But if there's a bomb or a fire or a gunshot, then there's a stampede and we see hyperstimulation, then it becomes chaotic and we don't see the same level of orderliness. And so the body's the same. When there's calmness in the ecosystem of the body, the biology, there's greater order. And when we have hyperstimulation, then there's greater disorder. So what we're seeing in our world today is extreme levels of hyperstimulation. I had off the charts hyperstimulation, and that causes more and more disorder. And that disorder shows up as a symptom to let you know, hey, there's imbalances here. You need to address them. And so we're seeing a lot of those imbalances showing up in our society with ADHD, with anxiety, insomnia, all of these really signals that we're getting as a society and individually that we need to change the way we're doing things. Mm-hmm. So for instance, someone walking along the street while they're walking and texting, that's going to cause a stress response in the body because the body now has to be on much higher, more high alert because it's doing a lot of things all at once and it can't take on all of that information around it because it's actually moving in one direction but looking at something else. And that simple thing can cause some very subtle but increase in the stress response in the body. And we're doing that all day long.
Yeah, it's interesting. As you said, I was a victim of doing it. I did that all the time in the past. It was almost a ritual to walk around the block, text, juggle a million thoughts in the mind. So maybe just to get practical a little bit, you talked about that disorder. And I think it'd be lovely to hear, because I know from a science point of view, I know from a research point of view, you've really invested in understanding this. So what's actually happening at a physical level, at a biological level, at a neurological level? What's happening in your, in our system when it is in chaotic state, like when this hyperstimulation is going on, when we're under stress, when we're almost in that system of go, 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 what's going on?
Yeah, it does actually, exactly like you said, it affects us physiologically, mentally, and emotionally. So on a physiological level, what's going to happen is your blood's going to, because your body's going, okay, it doesn't know whether, you're in a battlefield like Braveheart or facing a saber-toothed tiger, or whether you've just had a deadline that you've got to meet at work and you can't meet that, or you've got interest rates going up and all of a sudden you're getting stressed about your mortgage, or you had an argument with your wife and she's threatening to walk out on you. So all of those scenarios can create the same response in the body. The response itself is the same, but the situation that's caused a stress response can be different. So physiologically, what will happen is your blood will start to thicken because it's interpreting this as a dangerous situation. If you get bitten or stabbed, you don't want your blood gushing out. So that's why we're getting a lot of heart disease, blood coagulation in the blood. We're seeing your digestion shut down. That's why we get that dry mouth when we're stressed, because this is not a time for eating food. And because we're not producing the saliva to break down food, we're getting a lot of gut, irritable bowel, leaky gut, all that sort of stuff happening because we're simply eating on the run. We're not digesting properly. We're eating while we're stressed and we're not breaking down the food like we used to. Things like your breathing will change, your red or white blood cell count will change. You're starting storing fat cells because you might not be able to eat for a couple of days because you're in a battlefield or on the run. So your body starts to store the fat cells that will increase your cholesterol. That's happening physiologically. On a mental level, what's going to happen is that we've got right and left hemisphere of the brain, which is creative and analytical. But we also have frontal lobe and rear lobe of the brain. So the rear lobe of the brain is the reptilian brain. It's a very basic functionality of pure survival instincts. The frontal lobe, which we have as a human, the Homo sapien, we have this big forehead. Now, if you look at all the other Homo species, they don't have that big forehead. And the reason why we call the sapiens is because there was, I think, five Homo species, and we were called the Homo sapien the sapien means wise one. Mm. And that's because we develop this frontal lobe, which is our ability to make intuitive, mindful decisions, wise decisions. So the wisdom is considered to be at the frontal lobe of the brain. And that's why, you know, teenagers, they don't let them vote or do other things because they don't feel that apparently that development between the reptilian and the frontal lobe of the brain hasn't really developed until the ages of roughly around 20 to 24. Mm-hmm. That's why we see, you know, those young kids doing Jackass movies. So, you know, you wouldn't see a 35-year-old doing that usually because they've developed that frontal lobe at that point. And it's like, no, that's a stupid thing to do.
Yeah.
And so our brain functionality gets really impaired when we're stressed. We revert back into reptilian brain. When we're in a battlefield facing a Scottish marauding tribe, we're not thinking about, you know, a creative, mindful activity. We're just like, how do I either kill this person or run from this person? You've got a split second decision. And this is why a lot of men default to these two modes, unfortunately, because a lot of guys are in a stressed response. And when we're in a stress response, a lot of guys have a split second decision because they've defaulted back into their tribal mode. Mm-hmm. Oh, they've got to weigh up in a nanosecond. Is this enemy something that I can defeat or is it something that I need to run from? Mm-hmm. And so when we're in a really precarious situation, it could be a fight with your missus. A lot of guys will default back into that old mode, which is I either clam up and run away and go and get wasted or walk out of here because this is too hard, or they get really aggressive. Mm-hmm. And so we've got to evolve our way of navigating. This is why we need to be a lot more calmer in the way we operate in the world, because we actually want to be operating all the time from the frontal lobe. Mm-hmm. That's why some of the top companies in the world get their staff to meditate, because if that frontal lobe is deactivated, you're going to get a very impaired functionality out of that staff member. And they're back in default mode of like running or attacking. And then we don't want that in a boardroom.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think anyone listening to this will know those moments. We've all been through them. Yeah. I had, last year, I remember a moment where I regrettably went into that aggressive mode, and I recognize that, right? And I wonder what might have been going on for me at that moment. But in terms of maybe just to talk more practically for you, like let's go back to your story. You clearly understand this. You've done a lot of work, right? What did you... You know, if you look at that for you, what was practically going on in the old days? And then let's maybe look at how that started to evolve, what you've been doing to shift how you manage that.
Yeah, my default, because usually depending on the nature of the guy, I'm not a big, you know, bulky guy. So big, tough guys tend to default into the aggressive mode, whereas some other guys will default into the retract mode. My default was to retract, and that was back into fear base. So we can have the aggression forward movement or the fear retract movement. And mine was very much recluse and I couldn't go out. I couldn't go to work. We developed what's called agoraphobia. So eventually this blew up in 1996 where I couldn't go to work. I had to have mental health leave. I literally couldn't leave the front door of the house for a period of time. The overwhelm of my nervous system and its ability to cope with just daily functionality was so intense. But what I didn't finish on, that we went to the physical and the mental, but the emotional is the one that really affects us the most when we're having this stress response, because we get these high levels of cortisol, adrenaline, and norepinephrine into our bloodstream. What happens simultaneously, and they can't coexist, is we shut down really quickly melatonin, serotonin, and oxytocin. Now, again, this is not a disorder. This is actually your body working very orderly to create a life and death situation that you can get out of. And so what you don't want in a battlefield or fighting a saber-tooth tiger is you don't want melatonin in your blood, which makes you feel sleepy.
Yeah, sleepy. Yeah.
Right? You don't want compassion and empathy, which is oxytocin. We don't want you to feel love if you have to put a sword in someone's throat to protect you from danger. Mm-hmm. So this, like, if you look at the, you know, US Marines going into battle, you know, they don't want to have lots of compassion and empathy and love in that moment. So it's really hard for them to go out of the battlefield and back home to their families. And we see a lot of dysfunction with that because they're not learning to regulate their bodies back into the flip of that, which is creating more oxytocin, serotonin, and melatonin. So I had very little serotonin, oxytocin in my blood and melatonin for long periods of time, which means you can't sleep, you can't feel intimate or connected in your relationships, and you don't feel happy. So I had an immense level of depression, even to the point of suicidal tendencies. But the problem we have in the world is that we have a lot of people are in that state with low levels of oxytocin, serotonin, melatonin, high levels of cortisol, adrenaline, and in a seeing psychiatrists or putting on medication. There's nothing wrong with that if someone's using that as a modality, but we do have to get the body out of that stress response. Otherwise, it's literally pushing shit uphill. If you're not going to get those blood biochemicals, you know, change from being in that sympathetic nervous system state, then you're just going to be really hard to get the change that you need to happen. And for me, that was changed very quickly when I learned to meditate.
Yeah, wow. Okay. So if we look at the recipe, it's as a really high-functioning human, I need to be effective in stress. I will have stress, but I can't be in that in a as a full-time consistent process because I will deplete, you know, these other this other side. And on the other side, that's where my high function is, my care is, my empathy is, my good decision-making comes from, my ability to be patient, all of these other expectations that we need to navigate through in life. In any case, you can't have, you know, kind of life functioning well with on one side of the coin there. So you just said meditation was the tool or a key tool. How does that influence? What does that look like?
Yeah, you know, it's meditation, exactly like you said, it's the tool. It's not the state. Meditation induces the state. It's one of many different mechanisms. I found it the most efficient, most effective. I've been tried a number of different things leading up to that point of having change happen. You know, first thing happened was this incredible meltdown. I was just a complete wreck. And I'll take the audience through that moment because it was really a dark day, but also one of my significant turning points in my life. There'd been a buildup of those red lights on the dashboard, had been building up for quite a few years, but I just kept doing things, the same thing over and over again. And it accumulated and exacerbated one day. It was in February 1996. So I was getting ready for work. And I'd been getting these waves of panic attacks. Now, I didn't know what a panic attack was. You just get curled up in a ball and you can't move. You can't breathe. You got dizzy spells and pins and needles all over. And while I was getting ready for work, I remembered that day that I had a massive client lunch. It was with a large investment bank. That's going to be what we call an FTR. FTR means failure to return. So you know you're in for the long haul. It's a 4 to 5 hour lunch, potentially going through all the way into dinner time. So that was a very common occurrence back in those days. So it was labeled, hey guys, I'm going for an FTR.
Big
see
day,
you tomorrow.
Big lunch, yeah. Yep, the long lunch.
And it sounds all glamorous and exciting, but you know what I was contemplating at that point as I was getting ready is, what if I get one of those episodes again? What if I get stuck at the table? What if I can't get out? What if I make a fool of myself? What if I can't breathe? And I'm sitting there and this fear of fear, like you said before, what was the fear? At that point, there was some fear around a future scenario potentially playing out. And that activated this sort of huge tsunami of fear. And what happened was I collapsed on the floor. I couldn't breathe. My vision blurred. I felt like a knife had gone into my heart. I had cold, clammy sweats. I wanted to vomit. I wanted to go to the toilet. Everything was just exploding, my whole body. And then my wife took me to a doctor and he explained literally an hour later that I was having a nervous breakdown. And what happened in that moment was this stark realization of where I was at in my life. And I just burst into tears. I couldn't stop crying. I became like an uncontrollable wreck. And this realization that, hey, I'm pretty fucked up here actually. And it wasn't until that moment that I realized that there was something wrong. Up until then, you're just doing more coke and more partying and hoping that it'll all just go away someday. But that was the turning point where things were brought, the light was shone on it.
Were you talking to people? Were you exploring it? Like, what was going on? Because I'm assuming meditation or any form of transformation doesn't just happen to fall on your lap. There's clearly some exploration there. What were you exploring? How did you deal with that?
Yeah, the first thing that happened was obviously you're in the Western medical system at that point. So you're being diagnosed and then there's a pathway that they put you through. So the next step was immediately that morning, he sent me to the top psychiatrist in Sydney. He put me on medication and then you're on suicide watch at Prince of Wales Hospital and you're doing reports every day to check in that you're going to be alive and you're not going to take your life. And it was a pretty intense process of going down that Western medicine path. I had to take immediately mental health leave from work and you're seeing psychologists and all that. So you're doing the Western medicine path. I felt very inherently that there was something not right about, as the weeks went by doing the medication, I could feel myself sort of checking out. I just felt there was something innately this is not to say that anyone on medication shouldn't be doing it. It's just that for me, I felt something intuitively that that wasn't right, that this is my path. Mm-hmm. I have to put a pill in my mouth to try and make me better. Mm-hmm. And so interestingly at that time, you know, you're doing all the meetings and the interviews and talks and stuff like that. But I came across a documentary sitting at home, and this is 1996, agoraphobia, couldn't go to work. So you're just watching a lot of telly. And there was a documentary about a property developer, Bruno Grollo, very successful in the 80s and 90s. And during that interview, they talked about how he used a particular style of meditation called transcendental meditation. And I remember that word so distinctly because it sounded so appealing to me. I'd been spending the last 10 years trying to transcend reality using drugs and drinking. And here he was in this chair with his eyes closed in a pinstripe suit meditating. And it was like a light bulb moment for me. And I literally picked up the Yellow Pages that morning or that evening, whenever it was that I saw that documentary, and I went straight into meditation in the Yellow Pages. Anyone young listening, they wouldn't have a clue what I'm talking about. It's a book, which is our Google, basically. And that's when I started to look into meditation. And so when I went to the course and did the training, I literally knew immediately this is what I've been missing in my life. And so coming back to your original question, how did meditation make the difference? It's a really phenomenal process, particularly the style that I was using. You get a sound or a mantra and you repeat that inside your head. Now, the quality of that sound and the repetition of that sound silently inside your head, I was blown away at how powerful that was and what it did to my physiology. What it does is that when your mind drops into silence and stillness, and it did this very quickly using the mantra, then because there's no neurological activity in the brain, you're not thinking about future or past things, your physiological level of rest goes into a state of metabolic rest four times deeper than sleep. Now, that level of deep physiological rest is when your body moves out of the sympathetic, because you're not thinking anymore. So you can't be in the sympathetic. Yeah. You're just sitting with your eyes closed and your mind is now no longer thinking. Your physiology drops into a state of physiological rest that is the parasympathetic nervous system. Now, that's an intelligent design in the body to optimize. So the body goes, holy moly, we've got a messed up system here. It's time we start reorganizing this. And your body knows how to reorganize. It's a phenomenal piece of equipment. Mm-hmm. Never have any doubt the body's capacity, given the right environment and the right tools, obviously nutrition, fluids and all that, to optimize itself. If we cut our arm on a rose bush, then the body knows how to heal that. We just put some bandage on to stop the blood getting on our clothes.
Yes.
And so my body started to organize. And so very quickly, within days or weeks, I noticed a huge shift. I went back to work after a couple of weeks of learning to meditate, and in the end became one of the leading brokers in Australia, you know, playing at the top of my game after a 26-year career.
That's amazing. I want to squeeze all that bit of that because there's so much in it. So you've got Bruno Grollo, you've got the introduction and the experimentation with meditation, and then you go back to work, this place that ultimately had created the beast. So what's that transition back look like as far as integrating meditation, just functioning? You know, the drugs, the boozy lunches, that would have been a significant change. I mean, I can imagine other people in the office looking at you going, oh, what's going on here with Tom, right? Like, Tom just disappeared. Where'd he go? And then you're back. What was that like?
It was very confronting initially because everyone knew what had been going on. You know, where's Tom? You know, and that obviously they had to explain. So egoically, that was very challenging for me, you know, particularly in that environment. It was a brutal environment. And so learning to cope with that, obviously, and just deal with that and go back into the job and keep just prove myself in the job. But the biggest challenge was not just having to deal with the fact that, you know, I'd struggled mentally, but to prove that I could still stack it up in the job, which I could do, no problem once I got back in there. But the biggest thing was learning how to integrate this new lifestyle. Mm-hmm. Because when you start to operate and activate the parasympathetic nervous system, what you're doing is reducing cortisol and adrenaline, norepinephrine, increasing serotonin, oxytocin, and melatonin. So what happens is you naturally start feeling really good inside, day in, day out. You're just feeling much better consistently, not always, but more consistently. You have less of that stress response. And because you have less of that stress response, the cravings coming from that place of lack aren't there anymore. They just simply melt away. So the longing for the drugs and the drinking just simply melted away. It wasn't like, I'm not going to do them. It's just like, I really didn't feel like it really quickly. this is why I like working with people with addictions, because the addiction's not the problem, the gambling, the sex, the drinking, the drugs. What they're looking for is what those things will give them, which is a shift in their biochemistry. And certain people use certain mechanisms to get that shift, whether it's gambling or drinking or drugs. But when we make that shift internally through another mechanism that's more sustainable, let's say meditation, then what happens is those addictions just simply melt away. And so then the challenge for me was, well, how am I going to do my job, which is 50% trading on the floor? I was good at that no matter what. But the other 50% was the marketing.
Yeah.
And so I had to bring a point of difference. And look, in Venice, and this might be something for the audience, I consulted at the time my spiritual mentor who'd been guiding me through this meditation process. I said, look, you know, the practicality of my job requires a lot of entertaining with clients. And I'm not sure how I'm going to do this because I don't want to drink or do drugs anymore. And he shared a story with me. He said, look, if you think about this, at the end of the day of war, when the soldiers would put down their arms and they'd retreat back from the trenches, going back in, you know, World War I, World War II, and there was no night goggles, pretty much the battlefield would close down at the end of the day and they would retreat back to the mess hall. Mm-hmm. And the soldiers would start whooping it up with their whiskey and beers and getting wasted, standing on the mess hall tables and dancing and screaming and going crazy, covered in blood and slime, mud, everything. And the general would walk in. Now, the general would walk in his beautiful outfit with his badges of honor, showing how incredibly skilled he is in running this you know, battalion. And there'd be a hush across the room. Hey, the general's here, the general's here. You know, they all want to sit with the general. Come, you know, general, you want to sit with us? You know, and they all want to share space with the general. Mm-hmm. The general would come, have a light beer or maybe a water, spend an hour with them, chatting with them, and then he'd get up and bid them adieu and say, all the best for tomorrow, fellas. You did a great job today. I've got to go back to my, you know, tent and start strategizing for the next day. And then my teacher just said, you got to decide, you want to be a general or soldier. That's all there is to it.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was a really important time for me to own it rather than run from it.
Yeah.
And to feel okay about representing a new paradigm, a new way forward. And so I started thinking about different ways that I could be good at this job without doing it the old way. And so I started taking clients with their wives this time to the opera or to dinner or to a theater night, or I would take clients to Byron for a surfing trip and yoga trip.
Mm-hmm.
And so what it was, it actually interestingly became a point of difference, because in the old days, the clients would roll into their bed after doing some crazy stuff all night and their wives would whisper in there, well, you out with that Tom Cronin, he's terrible, just stay away from him. To, oh, Tom and Jen are so lovely. You should do more business with them. They're really good.
They're good,
so
yeah.
It was a flip on the way I was doing things at work, and it really helped.
Yeah, it's interesting that in every challenge there's an opportunity,
yeah.
And I'm glad you found that. And I think what I'd love to hear is that you work with clients all the time on these sorts of challenge, and then you've talked about this relationship between the meditation tool and then fundamentally a reframe, a redesign, so that they kind of coexist, don't they? How do you see that play out with anyone else who's trying to move away from their old self to be something different? How does meditation coexist with other forms of, I guess, development or change?
I think it's critical with all the different tools that we use for personal growth, personal development. And you've got to remember that this is something that didn't happen 50 years ago. Nan and Pop didn't do retreats and coaching and ice baths and breath work and meditation. So it's a very new phenomenon to have these modalities integrating into our daily work life and into life itself as a society. And for me, I go to the gym 4 times a week. I do yoga 3 times a week. I do sauna and ice baths. I do breath work. But my key practice is my daily meditation. I think until we really, on two levels, it's two levels that it really works, particularly the deeper styles that I teach and practice, is that we have to get the mind out of the thinking mode. So guided meditation, chakra clearing, all that sort of stuff's really good, gratitude.
Mm-hmm.
But to get the mind into a state of conscious awareness where there's no thoughts,
yeah,
is really critical on two levels. Physiologically, the level of physical rest in the body, which allows that optimization and up-leveling of the body on a physiological level,
yep,
is second to none. It's very hard to do that throughout any other modality. All the other ones are great, but this one is critical for the rest and the optimization. And secondly, we've got to get our mind out of the what we call vasanas. A vasana is a neurological pattern of behavior within the mind. So we have tendencies in the mind to think in a particular way. We have 40, 50,000 thoughts a day. 85% of those thoughts are repetitive thoughts of the day before and the day before and the day before. And it's like the water in the Grand Canyon. The longer the water travels down that route, the deeper the groove is, which means the longer it's going to travel down that route. And that's what happens to our neurological patterns. When we transcend the thinking mind, we access a field of creative intelligence. It's a field of wisdom. And it allows us from conscious awareness to observe our thinking mind and start to correct those imbalances or those anomalies in the way we think. It might be self-sabotaging thoughts, limiting beliefs, or just recurring thoughts on a daily basis. So really stretch the mind into a field, which is a vast field that lies and within it holds all possibility. Mm-hmm. I mean, everything that's ever created from this cup to this microphone to my phone to your watch was manifest as a cognition initially from that potential field, which means that everything that's going to be manifest is in that field right now, which is really exciting. And that's where I work with my clients. We do this on retreats as we do exercises to really stretch our mind out of the repetitive thought forms and start to extend it into the infinite field and see what's in that field that we want to play with.
Yeah, I love that. I'm a huge fan of what you've shared, and maybe just to share a bit of a personal story, because I was probably a little bit skeptical of some of this in the past. And after some fairly challenging stages of my life and realizing that some patterns I had were probably not that helpful, and just a few good people pointing that out to me, meditation was something I tried. And you know, there's a reason I'm going to share this story. Basically, what I did, it was a very, very simple guided meditation model, you know, jumping on the train in the morning, doing it. I was meditating in the middle of the second row. I'd always sit in the same spot every day, and I just, you know, 5 minutes. And, you know, what was happening, and I didn't sort of realize until that pattern had started, that chance to allow the body to breathe had occurred, was, or the mind to breathe to occur, was that it felt like that. It felt like there was breath. It felt like there was freer. It was getting a chance to make choice again. It was getting a chance to experiment, think differently about situations where I was making judgment or unhealthy assessment of situations, right? And you know, that I did that for, I had a little clock on it. It was in the end, it was hundreds of hours of consistent meditation over a period of time. So it's really transformed who I am today, in my opinion. But I share that not because, you know, I'm any better or because that was the only thing I did, but I share that because I think, you know, I don't meditate anymore. I don't do it that regularly. I do it occasionally. I know how to meditate now. Where does meditation fit in terms of a journey for the average person? How do you see it maybe combined with other sort of strategies? Where have you seen people do it for a period of time? Where have you seen people become so attached to that it's almost like for yourself, something you do every day? What's it look like?
What it looks like as a daily practice for me is what I recommend and what I teach is we meditate twice a day, once in the morning for 20 minutes, once in the afternoon. Mm-hmm. What I do is I ask my students, did you brush your teeth this morning? Everyone will say yes. Do you have holes in your teeth? No. Why do you brush your teeth? For prevention. So you can see it on two levels. One is I'm going to use this on a daily basis, just like I do with brushing my teeth, going to toilet, showering, sleeping, eating. Mm-hmm. They're non-negotiable, absolute essentials that integrate into my day. It comes down to how much you want to experience the optimization of life. Most people are pretty okay with living, I wouldn't say substandard, but a fairly mediocre and just get by type of life. Mm-hmm. But what we're starting to learn is, and we all know that there's a concept called enlightenment, and we all know that there are people that experience these profound states. What we have at the moment in the world is not a lot of interest in experiencing those states. It always comes back to Malcolm Gladwell's 10,000 hours. I don't know if you've read the book, The Outliers.
Yes.
And what Malcolm Gladwell revealed in the book, The Outliers, is that there were certain people that were outliers in our society, like Tiger Woods or David Beckham and Donald Bradman, because they spent a lot more time doing one thing than another thing. And we're all doing something. Everyone's doing something in every single moment. Mm-hmm. It's just a matter of what are we allocating our time to. So enlightened people have done only one thing differently than other people. And enlightenment is the optimization of the human experience. And we all have access to that optimal human experience. It's just that some people dedicated their lifetime to it. Mm-hmm. Some people have become really good at shopping, mm-hmm. really good at scrolling, really good at Sudoku, really good at worrying, really good at drinking, really good at gambling, you know, really good at turning up to the races on a Saturday. It's just that we have different preferences and time allocation. Mm. If we go back to Malcolm Gladwell's 10,000 hours, it's like, where are you allocating your time to have the optimal human experience? Tim Ferriss is a classic example of that. Mm. You know, Dave Goggins, classic example of that. Mm. They just become more dedicated and more specific with their time allocation into having a more optimal human experience.
That really resonates with me. And I wonder, you know, and I wonder for listeners listening to this, I think it's a good question to ask, is that experience with enlightenment, right? So for yourself, you kind of hit rock bottom and it gave you the chance to challenge yourself to, you know, to see there's almost no other direction you can go, right? It's only up. And, you know, when you describe enlightenment, you know, it feels like something that if it's practical and I can hold on to it, then I might go for it. What does it mean? What does it mean to be enlightened? What are we going for?
We're going for exactly the same thing that we go for when we grab a can of Coca-Cola. Mm-hmm. We're going for a class at F45, when we're going for, you know, having intimacy or sex with someone, when we're going to the movies, when we're going to clean our bathroom floor, when we're going to do our grocery shopping. Every single person on the planet is doing the same thing right now. They're seeking fulfillment. Mm. Every single action is motivated in the quest to find fulfillment. What enlightenment is the realization that it actually isn't in an outcome or an acquisition or an action. It's actually a self-referred state that they experience as a stable, consistent daily occurrence. And all that we're doing is we're seeking it in the shortest path possible, which is a bowl of ice cream or watching Netflix or listening to Spotify. But for those that are willing to play the long game, they find it through their regular, consistent practice. And, you know, I had one of my clients who was a trader at JP Morgan. About a week after learning to meditate, he texts me. He says, "Holy man, far out. I feel like I literally just had an Eki tab." And I said, "Well, what's happened is that your body very quickly is producing more oxytocin and serotonin, which is what the MDMA does. It triggers the bliss chemicals and you get this incredible high." Now, what we're doing with our practice is we're regulating the trickle effect of those biochemicals into your bloodstream so that you do get a sustainable production of those biochemicals. So you generally over time will feel a greater level of what we call bliss chemicals in our blood. So the beauty of that is that you're no longer in what we call outcome-oriented fulfillment. So everyone's in outcome-oriented, not everyone, most people are in outcome-oriented fulfillment, which is I need an outcome or an acquisition to make me feel fulfilled. Mm. But when we have self-referred fulfillment, it takes the pressure off the outcomes to be your source of fulfillment. Mm-hmm. Here's the catch. I know we don't want to go too far into this, so we don't want to overwhelm people. But when you feel at a vibrational level quite fulfilled, so you're emitting a frequency that's a higher frequency than the low frequency of feeling angry, tired, fearful, or whatever. When you're in a higher frequency of feeling quite fulfilled, which is bliss, happiness, joy, then what you start to attract in life will be things that are quite fulfilling. Mm-hmm. And so the irony is the less you need those outcomes because you're already feeling fulfilled, ironically, you start attracting more of those outcomes.
What I'm hearing is there's this transformation away from the action, the bowl of ice cream, the fast car, the whatever it needs, what you're seeking, and then you're finding this sense of fulfillment, which only you can determine what that feels like, but there's a chemical relationship there that you're noticing. And then this dimension around vibration, right? And I'm going to intentionally be a bit skeptical around it because I kind of want to understand this. I had a chat to someone the other day who listened to our podcast, and the great Trevor Hendy who's a wonderful human being, and he was referring to the fourth dimension. And this particular friend of mine, he said, "Look, love the chat, really respect the guy. What the hell is this fourth dimension? Like, I just can't, I'm not there. I haven't researched, I haven't heard about it, but now that I've heard about it, I'm curious, what is it all about?" So when you're kind of going from this idea of chemistry into vibration, what does that mean?
Yeah. So we all have, and let's bring it back into really basic scientific terms. We have what's called an event horizon or a sphere of influence beyond the physical mass. And someone might say, "Well, that's just bollocks. I'm just physical mass." Well, okay, so let's look at the sun. The sun is just a ball of fire, right? Mm. But then the sun has a sphere of influence that goes to Pluto and half again. Now, you can't see that, but you know it's there scientifically because Pluto and half again is caught in an energetic field of that ball of fire. There's light waves, there's heat waves. If I go and stand in the sun in the middle of summer, within 15 minutes, this will start to go red like a sausage under a grill because the sun, which is millions of miles away, is actually still influencing other things beyond its physical form. The Earth has a sphere of influence. The moon is caught in its gravitational pull. We're sitting on this chair because of the Earth's gravitational pull influencing us. We can't see gravity. Mm. So your friend will say, well, this is all bollocks. It's like, well, how are you sitting on a chair? Mm. Because there's a field beyond physical form that is energy fields that are playing out. The moon affects billions of tons of water every day in the tides. Mm. And we all have that. So if Cranky Sister walks into a dinner party, she'll throw that dinner party into chaos without even having to say anything. Mm. And we have sphere of influences on a positive and negative level, depending on at what point your frequency is in that frequency bandwidth, which is a hertz, H-E-R-T-Z. It's a measurable bandwidth of your actual vibrationary state. Mm. And your vibrationary state's like a Wi-Fi modem that's emitting a frequency, and it's starting to have some influence and effect on the field around you.
Okay. So if I walk into a party, I've got a look on my face, I'm walking a certain way, so I'm projecting, you know, my body language is telling you that, but I'm also, what you're saying is projecting a vibrational frequency that people will notice or feel in some way without even noticing that body language, without even me saying a word potentially.
Potentially, absolutely. And this is happening through lots of other things that we're creating. It can be through a book, can be a film, through a song, through businesses that you create. You know, your frequency is going into all of that. Mm. And it's being expressed as an extension of the state that you're in. Mm. You know, on a more sort of higher level, we've got this thing called darshan. Darshan is a Sanskrit word for the impact that someone in high vibration will have on other people. Mm. And so there's a lady called Hugging Ama, and she is this sort of 67-year-old, maybe 80-year-old now, Indian lady. And people will queue up in large conferences. She travels all around the world, places like the entertainment center or big auditoriums. And people will queue up for 14 to 16 hours in long lines. They get a number so they know when it's time for them to come into the auditorium to just simply get up and embrace from her. And the darshan, the activation of her vibration, which is so high and so powerful that for them, it immediately affects their state. It has a transformational effect on their state, just like the moon's affecting our tides. Mm. And it's so enlivening that people will be willing to pay money and queue up for long periods of time to get that darshan. And so some people can get it and from people in a negative way, then get it through people in a positive way. And, you know, you've got a classic example. If you look at Pol Pot or Hitler, their state that they were in translated into their actions, and their actions translated as a ripple effect into other people's lives to this day is still resonating and still rippling across other people's current state. You know, people who were in Auschwitz and things like that, or you got other people that were around thousands of years ago, their ripple effect might be still resonating through a sustainable long-term state, you know, your Gandhis or your Christs or people like that. So we have it on both levels, top side and downside, but there's an influence that we all have in the way we live our lives and the lives around us and how we affect the world.
Yeah, that's amazing. So and we can obviously influence that.
That's the
variable. So we get the choice. So I've heard in a previous talk of yours, Tom, about this idea of a rashi. So this idea that there are events or scenarios that might influence us, these seem to be resetting kind of stages. So is it that we are functioning and there are other kind of events that shape this? How does that work with respect to your journey, my journey, the average person? What's a rashi? How does that relate?
Yeah, it's a great question. If you want to go down that path. So it can be seen a little bit esoteric, but there's an evolutionary force, okay? An evolutionary force across the entire universe. And evolution is far greater than anything we think we want to do or, you know, how much control we have in our life. Mm-hmm. And that evolutionary force insists that things must evolve and grow and change. Mm-hmm. And there's only one of two options: to resist the evolutionary intelligence and force or to be in flow with that. Mm-hmm. And to resist it will mean that intelligence, which is you as well, you are that evolutionary force, of course, it permeates and is you, but it's all around you as well. We can resist that natural inclination to grow and evolve and be better, which will mean that we attract karmic consequences. There's a beautiful design that is always guiding and supporting us to make better choices. And that design, sometimes just like a loving mother or father with a naughty kid. Now, that parent might have to enforce some discipline on that child if it feels that it's drifting out of orbit of the path that it could live, and it's not growing up and evolving the way it should and could. And they might have to instill some karmic consequences to guide them. That they doesn't mean they're not coming from love, even though the karmic consequence might not be pleasant. And so I got extreme karmic consequences for 10 years, but I kept ignoring them. Now, what happens when we ignore, then the rashi is like a force that's so gargantuan that choicelessness is left. You can't ignore it. And only two options happen at that point. There's only breakdown or breakthrough. So an individual can get to a rashi, which is breakdown or breakthrough. And for me, that was where I was at. It was breakdown or breakthrough, which is suicidal breakthrough into a new level. A business will get to breakdown or breakthrough. Nokia, Kodak, Kodak's a classic example of the option to evolve and the resistance to that and the price you pay for that. So the engineer, I can't remember his name now, it was like 1983, I think he came to the board.
Created the digital camera.
Digital camera, right? Mm. And they said, hey, we're in film, put that away, don't talk to anyone about it. And so, of course, they went bankrupt in 2011. And that's because they didn't adapt and evolve and grow. And that's why Apple and Google are so damn good, because they're constantly adapting and growing and evolving. And where's a business? Where's an individual? Where's a relationship? You know, my wife and I have been together 33 years. The sustainability of that is partly in due, and it's not been perfect by any means. But we learn and grow and we adapt and we evolve and we find ways to make that work. And if it doesn't, then you'll meet a rashi and then it's breakdown or breakthrough.
So it's almost the acceptance that the rashi will come anyway.
You can avoid the rashi if you adapt beforehand. So the key to life, having more harmony and less chaos, is to be far intuitive and be what we call Brahma dominant, which is be more proactive in your evolutionary process without needing prompts. So if you're already taking that, you know, on yourself and being consistently ahead of the curve, then you won't need a rashi.
And
you just have a more harmonious existence, more successful existence.
It's really interesting. Almost every guest that we've had on this this podcast has, you know, they've achieved something. They've always achieved something, which is part of the reason they're here. And nearly all of them have had great discussion around this notion of making time to continually work on myself, knowing I'm going to be something I don't know I am yet. There's an evolution. There's a natural acceptance of evolution. And I know for me personally, one of the great things that happened for me, which was really good for me, was having been through that and accepting that when things like the pandemic arrived, that I actually welcomed it. I saw it as an opportunity. And I saw a lot of people in my circles see that as well. And others saw that as an extreme threat, you know, almost a frustration, you know, going back to your point, a sort of a breakdown or a breakthrough was a real climatic experience for them to hit that. How have you noticed, you know, with all of the people you work with today, I'd love to hear more about your work. Just that relationship between triggering to work with you, are they coming as a result of maybe that big moment, or are they coming more proactively now? Are they coming going, I know I've got to evolve, I just don't know why, I don't know where, this is just me in that kind of, I guess for want of a better word, the growth mindset?
It's really three different type of clients that come to me. I'm about to get on a plane about an hour after this session today to go to Melbourne, and that's client one, which is that I had a businessman was recommended to me to help him with his business and to reduce stress and learn to meditate, and he was very stressed. Very successful business, but was not having a good time of life because he was too stressed. So I told him to meditate. He was blown away by the very quick impact it was having on his life. And so he said to his wife, you've got to learn with Tom. You can have a private session and then Tom will fly down to Melbourne. So I'm flying to Melbourne to teach his wife. So there's referrals because people pretty much pull people by their ear, partners, you know, colleagues, friends, and says, you got to see Tom and have a session with him. The second client is people that are at the breaking point, and they might have heard a podcast or seen a video on my YouTube or Instagram or something and gone, okay, this is what I need because I've tried everything else and nothing else is working. And I'm my last sort of resort and I hope this works. And they're at those sort of breakdown sort of stage. And then you've got people that have been trying lots of different things to accelerate their life And they're already doing a lot of the modalities that are, you know, always supporting them, making their life better. Mm-hmm. Jack DeLose is a classic one, was already doing some great things in his life, who runs the Entourage, but he really wanted to go to the next level. Mm-hmm. And he'd heard that this practice, that's a deep transcending meditation, would really help him expand his mind and take his business and take himself in his trajectory of life to another level. So that's the third client.
Outstanding. Outstanding. So they come to you for all sorts of reasons. Okay. That's great. Look, you've been really helpful, Tom, and I've got to say, for me, I think people should experiment with this, explore it and give it a go, because to me, I've had that experience and I haven't worked with you directly, Tom, but maybe there's an opportunity. But I think there's something in this that, you know, going back to your point about everyone could identify with one of those three. Anyone listening to this could probably see themselves. Right now, if I was sitting at home listening to this podcast in my ear and I was to maybe even just test drive right now, an experience with meditation, what might you encourage someone just to see, to notice that feeling in the body, in the mind? What could they try if they're listening to this?
Yeah, you know, I give people a very simple starting point if they want to just have something on a daily basis, just to really center themselves and just calm things down a little bit. Ideally, what I recommend is, you know, people say, should I start with 1 minute or 5 minutes? Look, if we try to have a practice that isn't really showing a lot of gain, then it won't integrate into our life. We've developed very charming lives. That's why we have Uber Eats and Netflix and Spotify, because we're very good at creating a lot of pleasure. Shortcuts to pleasure. And so if you've got a practice that is eating into those sources of pleasure and not giving you pleasure, then you'll drop it very quickly. Mm-hmm. So that's why we recommend going all in and doing the Rolls Royce of it and getting a teacher to teach you how to do that practice so that you actually get heightened levels of, like that JP Morgan banker that said, I feel like I've just had an ecstasy. You actually notice very clearly
significant shift,
not just a significant shift like, I think this is making my life better. You actually just feel darn better day in, day out as a result of it because your biochemistry. But look, if people are stressed and, you know, they might never be able to access a Vedic or transcendental meditation teacher, then I just give them a really simple technique, which is just to close the eyes and focus the effortless breath, not a forced breath, but a very effortless breath moving through the nostrils. Mm. And what they'll find is that as it moves through the nostrils, there's a very slight cooling effect around the rim of the nostril. Mm. And that's where the air is brushing the moisture on the skin and slightly cooling the skin, because the air brushing the moisture cools the skin. And so we get them to really bring their targeted attention into one point to stop that flittering mind, which is causing those hyperstimulations in your nervous system in your body. And what they find very quickly is that they de-excite their mind and their body and their nervous system, and that allows a regulation and allows the system to start to reorganize itself. They're not going to go deep into transcendence, but it's definitely a really good calming mechanism mm-hmm. that you can do for 5-10 minutes. Mm-hmm. And we find people get a big benefit out of that.
So it's almost a tactic, maybe in between a meeting.
Absolutely.
Or something just to pause.
Center
early.
Yeah. And look, a lot of people are going to go, look, you know, gosh, I try that, but my mind just keeps wandering. It's like, that's like going to the gym, lifting a dumbbell, going, oh, that was too hard, I'm not going to do it. Mm. You know, the more you do that, you're developing a muscle. Mm. And so it's not that it's going to be easy, just forget that. It's definitely going to be hard because you've been scrolling all day on your Instagram and your emails. Mm. So acknowledge that it's going to be hard, acknowledge that it's challenging, but relish that challenge like you would an ice bath or breath work or going to the gym. And step into that space and go, this is going to be hard and this is going to be great for me to rein in my mind like a wild bucking bronco that suddenly gets a harness around it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the first few bucks, it's going to keep going.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. It's not going to really suddenly be rideable in the first go.
Yeah, totally get that. It's amazing. A couple of little questions.
Go for it.
So you talked about the brain and then you talked about this idea of going to the gym and the dumbbell analogy, which I totally resonates with me, but does the brain behave like a muscle? Like, in what way do you notice it change when you evolve through this meditation practice?
There's a few things on that. There's a great book out by Norman Doidge, The Brain That Changed Itself. So we know that the brain is malleable. It's phenomenal how much the brain can change. And so this is why I have a bit of a challenge. I mentioned this a couple of times, not to discredit anyone that's using medication, but if we're just looking at medication as a mechanism, we can do practices to help the malleability of the brain to adapt and evolve. And that's really exciting. So that's been scientifically proven that the brain is changeable. Secondly, when we meditate, it's really interesting. We get this cohesiveness in the two hemispheres of the brain. Because we're not thinking when we're in deep transcendence, that is, we're in a state of conscious awareness, we're not asleep, which is unconscious. We're in conscious awareness, but we're no longer having a thought.
Mm.
Right? And this is what we call transcendence, the fourth state. Now, when we're in that state, because we're either not having an analytical or creative thought or frontal lobe or rear lobe activity in the brain, we have full brain coherence. And if you go to Google, type in brain coherence meditation and hit EEG, you'll find there's a full brain optimization and activation and coherence. And what happens is there's an interesting expansion of the brain, and it presses up against the skull because it's actually expanding like a muscle that's being used. And they suggest that there's even an expansion, that this hairline crack down the skull that actually opens up. It's really quite interesting that you get a much greater, incredible use of your brain.
Yeah, wow. It's, I mean, not that people in the end will care whether the brain expands. It's just the fact that that's the function and it's happening. Yeah. And I think that is really interesting. And final question, and I think this is what I think a lot of people would love to hear about you, Tom. You've shared the story about, you know, the high performing, finance professional, in the broking trading game. And these days you're in business. How's it going for you?
Yeah, it's been a real interesting journey. I left finance around 10, 11 years now, and that was a really stable. I never had once really my job in jeopardy. You know, I was in the bond market, which was always pretty much a guaranteed market because the government's pretty much always running debt. And for 26 years, I was always on a multiple six-figure salary, never had any questions about that, super holiday pay, the works. Then going out to teach meditation, and look, you know, I took on a big project, which was to produce a film. We thought, wow, a really great thing we could do was to make a film that was going to showcase the power of meditation. And we got investors behind that. And the intention for that was partly twofold. One was we thought it would be a really good business model. This was on the back of The Secret that generated $300 million from a $3 million investment. And it was just phenomenal. We thought, wow, that's like, there's something here. There's some potential here in this model. And so we wanted to sort of replicate that. We got some money from some wonderful investors. But as that project unfolded, and I learned really hardly that in a hard way, that making a film is really, really difficult because there's so many different people putting their imprint on that.
Mm.
It's not like you just have all the say. You've got editors, directors, you know, producers, and so many different people trying to put their imprint on it. And to get the vision how you wanted it was much, much harder than I thought, to the point where we didn't actually get the vision that I initially intended because of all these people. And I was partly involved in that as well. And so also what happens is the outer landscape changes as well.
Mm.
And the outer landscape was that we had streaming platforms where people, you know, we've got 5 streaming platforms in my house, Disney to Binge to Netflix to Amazon to Stan. And so to have someone then go into a cinema or pay for a film outside of that just wasn't happening. And so that business model became really difficult. And I spent a long time at my journey going into that pathway that was unfortunately at this stage not a fruitful process, which also took me away from doing the things that I was good at and that I loved, which is the speaking, the retreats and the teaching. But now that I'm putting a lot more attention back into the coaching, the speaking, and working with Harvard, with Amazon, with Oracle, going to Melbourne today to teach in Melbourne for some privates, running big retreats up in Noosa in another month's time. So now I'm starting to see light at the end of the tunnel, but I won't kid you. You know, full transparency, we had to sell our house and a lot of my savings went into that project. It's been a really difficult ride and I'm just sort of starting to recover from that at the moment.
Oh, mate. I've been through one of those rides myself, but in a slightly different way, but there's a lot of learning from that. What has been the biggest learning in terms of, you know, the movie process, the publishing, the fact that it didn't work? What's been the biggest piece for you?
I think I can still see some particular points along the way. One of the things, and this is for everyone, you know, if you've got a vision, what happened for me was I really didn't trust my vision and my intuition on that vision. And I allowed a lot of other people to influence me and influence the vision and to just accept what their intention or their vision was of my vision. And I think if I'd actually, potentially in hindsight, it's always easy. Maybe if we'd stuck to the original vision and the original goal, maybe that project might have been a very different outcome.
Yeah.
So that was one thing that I learned. And the second thing I learned is that making money in film is a really difficult process, and making films is a really difficult process.
Yeah. Leave it to the film guys.
Oh
right?
My goodness, yeah. So, you know, even people say, why don't you just sell it to Netflix? I mean, Netflix, this was the first time at Sundance Film Festival 3 months ago that not one streaming platform ever bought a documentary. Like normally they're buying a lot of documentaries at the film festivals. But these days, Netflix, Amazon, ITV, Apple TV, they just make their own, and they're really good at making them. They're making them only in three main areas. They're making them in sport, so Full Swing and Welcome to Wrexham and all that. They make them about celebrities, so the Pamela Anderson, and they're making about true crime. That's what they're focusing. Mm. Unfortunately, not about meditation yet, but maybe next year.
There's time.
It's not over yet.
Yeah, very good. And so now all of this work seems really practical, really quite influential in the direct sense. What's that doing for you now? How are you feeling about it all?
I'm excited about the future. I've got a lot more clarity about what my path is and where to allocate my time. This is the big challenge with entrepreneurs. If anyone's out there as an entrepreneur, our challenge is always those shiny objects that are constantly pulling us in many different directions. And so about sort of really being precise and clear about my attention, you know, coming back to Malcolm Gladwell, the 10,000 hours, you know, where's my time allocation, and making sure that I'm optimizing my time in the areas that A, I love, and sticking with the things that I love, and B, that I'm good at. So you got to love it. You got to be good at it. And you've got to have a business model that stacks up. And that's one thing that I teach my clients when I'm coaching them, is that you might love your job as a yoga teacher. You might have a passion for your job as a yoga teacher, but is your business model stacking up? So I help them build a business model that allows them to thrive and survive in that.
Yeah, we don't go very far without the fuel of that business model working.
Absolutely. Right? Yeah. It's core. And that's why a lot of them, you know, one of the first question I ask them is, how much do you want to make out of doing this on an annual basis? Like, oh, it's not about the money. I don't ever think about that. I'm like, well, that's why you're sleeping on your friend's sofa and you're not making anything and you're working in a part-time job. Mm. We do need to look at the numbers, and we need to make sure that this model is going to work for you. Otherwise, it's going to be very difficult.
Yeah. I find a lot of players in your space that mental wellness, health, have a deep care for their people, for their tribe, for their practices. But it's so much more powerful when it's got that fuel behind it. And I'm glad that you're working through that, mate. I hope it really kicks for you. It sounds like you're doing amazing work, and all of the organizations that are engaging you, I gather, are getting some really good results, which is great, mate. So well done.
Yeah, thanks. It's taken a while, but we're getting there.
Yeah, good man. Good man. Well, Tom, if anyone's looking for you, how do they find you?
Good place is Instagram. I'm most active there. Read all my messages, respond to all my messages. They can follow me and message me there. I'll go to my website. So it's Tom Cronin on Instagram, or tomcronin.com on my website.
Good man. Mate, I'll leave it there, but I've been hugely appreciative of the time. I really love the sense of focus and the sense of like deep understanding of this piece that you really have invested in over the years. And I think that's testament to you, A, recovering, B, you know, wanting to make a difference in the world, and C, being an absolute expert at what you do. So keep it up. I'm grateful for it. I think a lot of our listeners would have really got a lot out of that, and I hope it all keeps going well for you, mate.
Thanks for that. Thanks for inviting me along. It's been great. Thanks for listening in, everyone.